you catch that? Lamar stated views. Please put out that line in the song.
Lamar is just like on a whole different way.
Hate the popo. Want to kill us in the street? Oh, sure.
Getting on the track with Kendrick. I can never tell what he's going to do.
Why I say that hip-hop has done more damage to young African-Americans than racism in recent years.
Kendrick Lamar Duckworth is arguably one of the most influential rappers of this generation. Born and raised in Compton, California, Kendrick has proven his rap abilities and creative dexterity from a young age under the pseudonym K-Dot. His mixtape, Youngest Hit Nigga in Charge in 2003, gave a young K-Dot local recognition and it led to him securing a record contract with Top Dog Entertainment, or TDE, at just 16 years old. Under this label, K-Dot would release multiple mixtapes. He dropped Training Day 2 days before his 18th birthday, then No Sleep Till NYC in 2007, working heavily with upcoming rappers J-Rock, Absol, and Schoolboy Q. After receiving a co-sign from Lil Wayne in 2009, K-Dot released C4. In the same year, the Kendrick Lamar EP was released, and it was also around this time where he shed the stage name K-Dot. He proclaimed his birth name as his rap name, Kendrick Lamar.
I can tell you what it is, I can tell you what it isn't. No more K-Dot, my mother had named me Kendrick. Fuck a stage name.
Then finally, Kendrick's last and most popular mixtape, Overly Dedicated, was released, where Kendrick grew considerably as a rapper and really started to grow his now devoted and dedicated cult following. But with so much success and skill in the rap game, he's been battling the line between the godlike savior of hip-hop in the eyes of his fans and the mortal man when he looks in the mirror named Kendrick Lamar. So let's dive in and take a closer look into the artistic masterpiece that is Kendrick Lamar's DAMN. Kendrick Lamar has a respectable discography of 5 studio albums in 2022, 6 if you count the Black Panther soundtrack, and 7 if you count Untitled Unmastered, with every album almost immediately joining a conversation of being a classic. Through themes of street crimes, growing up in Compton, and longing for the unity of his people, Kendrick has always made music about how outside influences affected him, but it wasn't until DAMN where Kendrick Lamar really started to dive in and talk about how he affected his external life and what he felt internally.
The first track of the album, Blood, sets the tone and theme for what the LP is going to be about. From the first words uttered with Beck and saying,
"It's a weakness, it's a weakness, you decide."
The theme of this album is based on a duality of man, his wickedness versus his weakness, and the struggles man, specifically Kendrick Lamar, goes through throughout a lifetime. Kendrick Lamar starts the album off telling a story about meeting a blind woman who looks like she lost something. After watching her try to search for what she was looking for, Kendrick Lamar walks up and asks her if she needs a helping hand. The blind woman replies,
"Oh yes, you have lost something. You've lost your life."
It's a wickedness.
Right off the bat, the question asked at the beginning of the song is answered. Kendrick Lamar and you, the listener, has chosen the path of wickedness.
Like, where do we go? Hit her, and we hate popo. When they kill us dead on the street for sure. Hit her, I'm at the preacher's door. My knees getting weak and my gun might blow, but we go be a...
Did you catch that? Lamar stated his views on police brutality with that line in the song, quote, "And we hate the popo. Want to kill us in the street for show." KG.
Ah, please. I don't like it. I mean, you know I don't like it. That's why he came to me. I get it. That's his right to express himself. Let the free market decide. Personally,
Kendrick Lamar has met the blind woman and tracked himself and a listener down the path of wickedness, effectively foreshadowing a death. but we'll get back to that later. The news clip played at the beginning of the song shows how white American media portrays Kendrick Lamar and his messages, specifically the track All Right from To Pimp a Butterfly. Somehow turning a message of hope into hatred. Kendrick, now down the path of wickedness, responds to this in a more bold and harsher message, DNA. Wicked Kendrick, fed up with racially biased opinions on his music, put up a double-sided mirror to himself and his people on one side and white America on the other. He describes his upbringing and how it shaped him from a child. Kendrick then raps about the other side of this mirror he's held up to white America. I know how you work, I know just who you are. See, use a bitch, you almost probably switch inside your DNA. Kendrick starts calling them spineless and cowardly, reminding them of their genetics and how they came to power in the first place. This metaphysical mirror seems to have them unfazed though. This frustrates Wicked Kendrick, sending him to an anger-fueled outburst on the second half of the track. Tell me something. Motherfuckers can't tell me nothing. I'd rather die than to listen to you. Kendrick then starts listing off about how he's stuck in a matrix and still manages to find success in the corrupted system, mocking them and taunting them, not realizing that he's falling deeper and deeper into the path of the wicked man.
Y'all know what happens on Earth stays on Earth.
On the track Element, the motif of what happens on Earth stays on Earth is said for the first time. This is actually the original title for the album, but Kendrick thought it was too long and scrapped it.
Did you ever have another album title for Damn?
Yep.
What was it?
What Happens on Earth stays on Earth.
What happens on Earth
stays on Earth.
Why not that? That's a long ass title.
That's a long. There you go.
Yeah, you know what I'm saying? That's Kendrick Lamar. What happens on Earth? What is do you have that new Kendrick? What happens on Earth?
Wicked Kendrick has already sealed a fate with the track DNA, sending out a message that can't be taken back. So he doubles down. I don't give a fuck. He raps about going back to his old days as K-Dot, going eye for any wrongdoings from any opponent in his way. Put the Bible down and go eye for an eye for this shit. D.O.T. my enemy won't catch a vibe for this shit. Aye. Usually when people do things out of aggression, they have to rationalize it in their head so they don't feel like some sort of wild animal. The ego will provide some type of reality they're used to or reasoning to protect themselves. Wicked Kendrick does just that and mocks anyone who's opposed to him. If I gotta slap a pussy ass nigga, I'ma make it look sexy. If I gotta go hard on a bitch, I'ma make it look sexy. I pull up, hop out, air out, made it look sexy. In this storm Wicked Kendrick has created, made up of hatred and aggression, he rationalizes his words and actions with the philosophy of predestination. John Calvin, a French philosopher, argues that your fate is decided long before you're born. That you're destined for either heaven or hell regardless of your actions during your life. Wicked Kendrick raps about having a very similar thought process. Damn if I do, if I don't, yeah. God damn us all if you won't, yeah. Damn, 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 it's a goddamn shame. You ain't frontline, get out the goddamn way. Yeah. On the track Humble, Wicked Kendrick seems to have garnered this holier-than-now presence while boasting about his lifestyle and his braggadocious lyrics. He simultaneously tells everyone that they need to be humble and sit down. As a side note, one bar that I just learned what it meant was actually, who that nigga thinking that he frontin' on man? Get the fuck off my stage, I'm the Sandman. The Sandman is the person who will come out to get a bad act off a stage during amateur hour at the Apollo starting in the 1930s, usually tap dancing and escorting them off the stage. Maybe you knew that, maybe you didn't. I just think it's funny to picture Kendrick Lamar tap dancing other rappers on stage. Follow me. Back to Kendrick's fall into wickedness. On the track Lust, the sound of the sticky, sappy strings play with a haunted vocal in the background, auditorily displaying how Wicked Kendrick is now stuck in his ways and he's haunted by his wicked thoughts and actions. On the first lines of the track, he says, I need some water, something came over me, way too hot to simmer down, might as well overheat. This can be interpreted that Wicked Kendrick is now looking for saving, water in the context of holy water. On a track Sing About Me, I'm Dying of Thirst on Good Kid, Mad City, This was a defining song for his growth, seeking God's direction and need for spiritual cleansing. There seems to be a small slither of hope for this now wicked Kendrick, but it's immediately reversed on the next bar.
That's blood rush, my favorite thing. Heartbeat racing like a junkie's. I just need you to want me and my accent to mine.
It's revealed that Wicked Kendrick isn't speaking to God, but instead a woman, falling into his sexual desires instead of a higher calling. Basically, Wicked Kendrick wasn't thirsting for guidance, but he was just thirsty. Kendrick then starts rapping from the perspective of a lustful man.
Wake up in the morning, think about money, kick your feet up. Watch you a comedy, take a shit, then roll some weed up. Go hit you a lick, go fuck on a bitch, don't go to work today.
He ends the verse saying, whatever you do, just make it count. At first, this sounds like the ideal for a man, but then you're hit with the jab.
I need some water.
This is a warning that an entire life could be wasted on these things when your mind is full of lust and not love. He immediately goes into the same day, but from the perspective of a woman.
Wake up in the morning, thinking about money, kick your feet up. Hop in the shower, put on your makeup, lace your weave up. Touch on yourself, call up your nigga, tell him his shit. Credit card scam, get you a visa, make it pay your rent.
After examining what others have filled their lives with, Kendrick looks upon his own life and lustful lifestyle. Wicked Kendrick then starts listing off things he's been lusting over since he's taken the path of wickedness.
Lately I feel like I've been lusting over the fame. Lately we lust on the same routine of shame. Lately my lust been heightened.
Bringing up the Bible verse John 4:4, Kendrick expresses how his friendship with the world or his lustful lifestyle concurrently makes himself an enemy of God.
Lately in James 4:4 it says, friend of the world is enemy of the Lord.
Brace yourself.
Lust is all
I
yours.
Stays on earth.
The track Duckworth starts with Beckon making an appearance again, singing.
It was always me versus the world, until I found it's me versus me.
Kendrick has the epiphany that rather than overcoming the challenges the world has thrown at you, you have to first overcome his own internal challenges for anything to ever change. His lust, his fear, his pride. Rather than focusing on how the world is affecting you, you have to realize how you're affecting the world. This epiphany is explained in further detail on the track Fear. Kendrick is calling out to God, not understanding why he's cursed.
Why God, do I gotta suffer? Pain in my heart, carry burdens full of struggle. Why God, do I gotta bleed?
The song then reverses the same bridge, representing God taking Kendrick back to when he was 7 years old. Kendrick is now back to when he was a child and experiences again his past fears of getting beat by his parents.
I beat your ass, keep talking back. I beat your ass, who bought you that? You stole it, I beat your ass if you say.
Kendrick goes through the reasons why he would get beat as a child, ranging from not finishing his homework to getting his Jordans dirty. Fast forward, and Kendrick learned to take the easy way out of fear by picking up the habit of smoking, which is only escape from his fear for a single night, just for him to continue the cycle the next day.
If I could smoke fear away, I'd roll that motherfucker up.
Kendrick is now 10 years older now, and his fears of parents have been replaced with fear of death.
I probably die anonymous, I probably die with promises, I probably die walking back home from the candy house, I probably die.
Fast forward another 10 years and Kendrick is 27, explaining how his fears have transformed into a fear of losing everything he's created, questioning if God is playing some sort of sick joke on him.
At 27, my biggest fear was losing it all. Scared to spend money had me sleeping from heart to heart. Scared to go back to section 8 with my mama stresses.
The sample used in the song is called Poverty's Paradise, and it's a ballad about a man's fear of not having the means to feed himself and his family. I feel that this sample was used specifically for that verse.
Poverty,
I don't think I could find a way.
Kendrick's fear of a child has evolved into greater fears in his adult years because he never dealt with them. They never truly went away, but just piled on top of each other to create this mountain of anxiety. After Kendrick lists off his current fears of losing creativity, losing love, and losing his humbleness, to name a few, Beckon returns to say,
God damn you, God damn me, God damn us, God damn we, God damn us all.
God has answered the question that Kendrick was asked in the beginning of the track by showing Kendrick his reoccurring themes in his life. But the question still stands of, does he take this epiphany and run with it, or does he continue to live his life in the hell that he's in? More insight to the explanation is described on the tracks XXX and God. Starting with the track XXX, Kendrick receives a phone call from a friend who recently found out that their son was killed and pleads to Kendrick for closure and spiritual help. Kendrick responds with,
Mikey sugarcoat the answer for you, this is how I feel. If somebody killed my son, that means somebody can.
After rapping about the rampage and hell that he would bring onto the people who killed his son, he then hangs up the phone and the song takes a hard turn where we see Kendrick talking to kids about gun control.
She call you back.
Alright kids, we're gonna talk about gun control.
Pray for me.
Damn.
On the track God, Kendrick raps about his successes and how he's worked for everything. He's feeling untouchable like God. On the flip side, he contradicts this comparison to godliness by begging not to be judged for his human actions.
Don't judge me, my mama caught me with a strap. Don't judge me, I was young, fucking other rats. Don't judge me.
In this track, Kendrick is found in the median of wicked and weak. He tells a story of two strangers. The first, a man named Anthony, he grew up in the projects and ended up selling drugs to get himself out the projects, but continued to live his life of drugs and crime and was successful and started making a decent amount of money. Anthony was a very lucky man, being charged with murder because of his fingerprints on a gun, but not being proven guilty. This is around the time where he meets Ducky, the second stranger, working at a KFC. Ducky is a man who just moved to California with his girl, a couple hundred dollars to their name, and a son. Working his 9-to-5 and hustling on the side, Ducky knew about Anthony and how he robbed the KFC before that ended in people getting shot. So Ducky would get Anthony and his crew free food to get on their good side. Anthony eventually ended up robbing the KFC again, and had Ducky not found a way to navigate his situation without conflict, they would have both been a statistic. Kendrick then reveals the two men that he's rapping about.
Because if Anthony killed Ducky, top dog could be serving life while I grow up without a father and die in a gunfight.
The gunshot at the end seals the fate of Wicked Kendrick. How extraordinarily lucky was this situation? Two complete strangers who almost ended their lives ended up being Kendrick Lamar's father and boss. The two people who were extremely influential on him and molded him into the man that he is today. But the wickedness that he's chosen in the beginning of that album was never dealt with, and it took his life. It's pretty bittersweet, huh? But then the album reverses, revealing an alternative story of Kendrick Lamar's DAMN. Listening to this album in reverse order, you along with Kendrick take the reverse path of weakness, and the project is experienced in a completely different way. Kendrick Lamar even released a collector's edition of his album with the tracklist reversed for listeners to hear this version easier. At first glance, it may seem that he's constantly contradicting himself, but every song and the feeling attached to it has been placed there for a reason, to create an endless loop of the human experience. From the blood of being born versus the blood of dying. From the DNA of a mortal to the thoughts of Yahweh. From living a life full of love to living a lust-filled life. From being in your carefree element to having to sit and feel. From prideful to humble. And from living a life of fear to moving like a god amongst men. Kendrick Lamar effectively uses Deuteronomy to show his true self. If you look at a lot of these song names like fear, love, pride, and lust, philosophers have been debating about these topics for centuries. There's just no way you can answer everything in a 55-minute album. Kendrick was trying to understand these feelings for himself rather than provide answers for them. So does Kendrick Lamar hear God and take the epiphany, or does he continue to live a damn life in hell? Well, he's only human and humans are complex. If you haven't guessed it yet, this album doesn't have the answers. It only gives insight and perspective for the paths that we'll have to take eventually in our lifetimes on Earth. Because whatever happens on Earth stays on Earth.